Welcome back. Well, yes, still continuing on that particular matter. We've got Mr. Norrison Quakers, a senior advocate of Nigeria. Thank you for coming on this morning.
My pleasure.
Well, this interesting matter now, but that decision by the national, the House of Reps, you know, because that could have happened, present as Jimmy, that there was some irregularity that was going on at the House. But situate for us now the presumption of regularity in this particular matter. Does any such thing exist, and where does it lie?
Yes, it does exist, presumption of regularity, in the sense that if you go back in time to what transpired, to what led to the National Assembly, the House of Representatives stepping in, is to the effect that when the House was inaugurated by the governor, there's a perception that only a few members were present for the inauguration. But the fact is, the conduct of the governor, is it constitutionally recognized? The answer is yes. When the governor went there, the number of legislators who were there were the ones inaugurated. So the governor had declared a house open for function of or carrying out their legislative powers and functions. Now, having done that, and a speaker emerged, those who were not present will eventually present themselves to be sworn in because the governor has performed his constitutional function and role, and the matter ends there. So there's a presumption of regularity to that extent.
About the particular one, because, I mean, we were asking about the issuance of that proclamation, which you saw Honorable Namdas was saying that, well, he has to issue a fresh notice. But in terms of the time frame, much as the law says immediately, is there a particular time with which that has got to be done? And is there something irregular about that issuance?
No. We must be very careful so that we don't make political statements in the face of clear and unambiguous provisions of the law. Now, someone once asked me this question. Can the House of Representatives, for instance, issue a proclamation that or a directive to the Inspector General of Police to take over the functions or close up or seal up the Edo State House of Assembly? And what I said to him is, whatever we do, we must always have recourse to what the Constitution stipulates and what it says. Whatever we do, we must not go outside the Constitution. Now, you have a situation where the Constitution empowers the governor, just as it empowers the president, to declare the National Assembly open.
Yeah.
And so it's the same thing here. Now, assuming the president gets there, and mind you, this situation is not new, it's not novel. You recall that sometime back, under Dr. Bukola Saraki, a certain number of senators were not available when the House was inaugurated and when the Senate president eventually emerged, and so it became an issue. Now, eventually it was resolved. Now, you have a situation where a certain number of legislators were available when the governor made himself. First, was there a notice to that effect? Answer is yes. If you chose to stay away, knowing that a notice had been issued, or perhaps maybe some of them said they were not aware.
Yeah.
Some said they were not aware. But the fact is, was there a notice in that regard?
So ignorance is not tenable.
It's not tenable. It's no excuse.
So what then happens in this situation? Because having formed a quorum, can they sit?
Yes.
So if they can sit, so what's the problem?
No, that's what I said. The Constitution is very clear. You must always have recourse to the Constitution. How many of them were present at the time of the inauguration? Now, if the number present forms a quorum, that's constitutionally valid.
What about the time that they have to sit? Because the House of Reps also raised that, saying, look, some of them were not properly dressed, they didn't sit at the appropriate time. How valid is that?
No, see, for me, we must go beyond that. The House of Representatives, with due respect to the leadership, has no power to give such directive or to look into such crisis. What do I mean by this? If you look at the Constitution, I think Section 11, 4, and I think 5, more particularly Section 5, it talks about the National Assembly, and not even the House of Representatives, where legislative functions can be taken over by the National Assembly and not House of Representatives. And it clearly states where the House of Assembly of the state can no longer sit to perform legislative functions. So they step in to ensure public safety, public order. That's the only constitutionally valid situation that situations like this can even occur. Now, some time back, I think he was under Chief Olusegun Obasanjo as president, when there was crisis in Plateau State and a state of emergency, I think, was declared at that time where legislative function was also taken over. Mm-hmm. Now, if you look at 11.4, it says where the House of Assembly of the state can no longer sit to discharge its duties. Yeah. So the National Assembly now assumes the powers of the House of Assembly of the state in order to avoid constitutional crisis. Because if you look at Section 4 that talks about legislative powers, mm-hmm. one thing that you will observe that it says the National Assembly.
Yeah.
Now, the National Assembly is constituted by the Senate and the House of Representatives. So it's not one arm of government or one arm of the state arm that will now take over the functions of...
I was wondering then, well, because, you know, even there, the Edo State House of Assembly, while addressing pressmen, the representative, the chairman of that committee, said it's the business of the National Assembly. And this decision was taken at committee level in the House of Assembly.
Yes.
And it wasn't, so we haven't heard of a committee from the Senate, you know, joining and all of that. So does that make this an illegality or
certainly
a non-issue?
It makes it an illegality. It makes it an illegality. Perhaps one can even go a step further by saying that it should be seen as a decision that was never taken. Well, because it didn't comply with the clear and unambiguous provisions of the Constitution.
So
it has to be the National Assembly.
So now, going forward, what happens? This proclamation or order or whatever?
Before we actually go forward,
I'm wondering that if there was a proclamation in existence, how comes the letter or statement was later on issued for the other members to be inaugurated?
No, you know, like I said, the inauguration has taken place, constitutionally supported and backed. Now, those members who were not available, and now you can even take it this way. If, for instance, look at Rochas Okorocha, for instance, and a few others who had issues in terms of being given their certificate of return. Now, after the House had been inaugurated, or they said they made themselves available to be sworn in. So you can have such instances. If some members stayed away or something happened and they were not available, anytime they show up, there can be a vacuum. Mm-hmm. There must be a speaker to swear in,
you know,
those who are not available.
If I follow up on what they said, because you say that this can be considered at best as something that never happened.
Yes.
Because it's supposed to be a decision of both the House and the Senate.
Yes.
Meaning the National Assembly.
Yes.
Now, assuming the Senate,
yes,
agrees with the position of the House of Representatives, or they agree that there is irregularity in the first instance, so how then will that stand if this is something that never happened?
No. See, then you'd then be looking at walking to the answer. You have a situation where the second arm of the legislative arm of government, and that is the House of Representatives, has made a proclamation. So you do not have any evidence. Mind you, a motion was moved at the floor
of
the House.
Yeah.
When this step was taken.
Mm-hmm.
You don't have such proceedings in the Senate. Mm-hmm. No motion has been moved. The Senate has also not constituted a committee to look into it. So you have a situation where the House of Representatives has taken the decision and given this directive without recourse to the provisions of the Constitution. And that's what makes it a nullity.
So if the House, if the Senate eventually comes up with a resolution on this matter, it means that there may not be any grounds for the National Assembly to take a decision.
Yes, I want to believe so. Because, you see, it talks about when they can step in. You understand? The Constitution is very clear. And it says that where the House of Assembly of the state cannot be constituted, where they cannot sit.
Mm. Because
you're saying that they can't sit.
I think they're already, because they were the ones that were speaking with the governor.
Yes.
The Senate committee.
Yes.
So they're looking into that matter already. That's why they now said, look, it has to be the National Assembly.
Certainly. I mean, the Constitution is very clear.
So
if you look at, like I keep saying, our greatest challenge as a people is our inability to follow rules and regulations, and it's pathetic. You can't subject laws to the whims and caprice of some individuals. I shouldn't be seen to take advantage of the law because somebody up there is a relation of mine or a friend of mine. The law wears a blindfold. And we've said it time and again that the maiden of justice wears a blindfold. Why does the maiden of justice wear a blindfold? Somebody said in Nigeria, the maiden lifts the blindfold.
That's a funny one. So
we must learn to do things properly.
But you know that by convention and by practice, inaugurations are meant to be like very big events.
Yes.
Families are usually invited, it's very jolly and all of that. I'm wondering how it is that an inauguration of that as what it ought to be will get to that point that you have just 7 members inaugurated. Didn't the others hear about the inauguration? Since it's meant to be something that is momentous, even for the state, or did they just refuse to present themselves?
You see, the greatest challenge is this. Is there proof that notice was issued?
There was a proclamation.
Exactly. Once that is there, it means that some people, in fact, you could take it that everybody heard. It's just for you to come forward to simply say, I'm not even aware, the notice was never sent to me, except where there's a situation where you're expected to acknowledge the notice. It means when you serve it on, they will be members personally, and each person signs up, then it will now fly. But not the situation where...
Is this a trap for the state government?
I I don't want to conjecture, and I don't want to go into the politics of it. I want to face purely the law. And what does the law say? And that's the way to go about all of these things. There's no need for us to heat up the politics unnecessarily. Some people are saying, it's because they want to be constituted so as to impeach the governor. I mean, that's far-fetched.
What you said earlier brings me to the question of, we've gotten to the point where we are now. You talked about people not taking advantage of the technicalities of the law. But it would then seem that it was the law itself that even made itself open to be taken advantage of. For instance, the law says, the Constitution says, look, as soon as he is sworn in, they said the governor in question was not sworn in with this assembly. It was sworn in before. So that's one loop.
No, really. The governor will always come in before, it is the governor that swears in the House of Assembly.
Yes.
Same thing with the president. It is the president that swears in the National Assembly. And at the point of inauguration, both legislative chambers are expected to come together. You have the Senate and you have the House, they all come together, and the proclamation is made. And so the president inaugurates the National Assembly. Same thing with the State House of Assembly. It is the governor. Once he finishes that function, he leaves. Now, it is not his business to know whether the notices have circulated or it has been given. His own is to go there, and once he gets there, whoever he meets, he must perform his function.
Which then raises the question of how that letter or that proclamation is made, right?
No, question is, was it made? The how is not the issue. Was it made?
Should it be remade?
I don't think so.
As demanded by the House of Reps.
No, you see, you cannot orally, so to speak, amend the clear and unambiguous provisions of the Constitution. The man has discharged his constitutional responsibility. He has inaugurated the House. Those members who were not available would then now subject or submit themselves to the current speaker to be sworn in. Now, when they form him, it's not an issue. When they form a majority, if you want to impeach the current speaker, you can impeach him.
There
are ways of going about it.
A number of things come up here, and perhaps the mindset of they always talk about the drafters of the law. Did they envisage such a scenario? Even though they say, they don't envisage that everybody may be present for this kind of matters. But if it's going to be a momentous occasion, and then this happened maybe, as they say, some say in the night, even if it's validly proclaimed, the issuance of that proclamation, am I now supposed to be doing night vigil, not so as to be sure that these guys will not go and inaugurate the House, and then I'll be on the other side if perhaps they're planning something against me? Is that what the drafters intended?
Certainly not. But now, let me alarm you. The Constitution is unique. I keep saying this. It might not be a perfect document. It's a work in progress. In every society, laws are amended based on contemporary development. You remember under President, the late President Yar'Adua, the issue of transmission of letter and empowering the vice president to so act became an issue when Yar'Adua traveled for medicals, and there was no official engagement, as it were, of the then vice president to step in acting capacity. Now, the constitution has now been amended to now explain transmission. So it's work in progress. You can't develop if you don't take into cognizance societal changes in society. So laws are amended based on exigencies of the times. Now, are you aware that in the constitution, if I am vice presidential or vice president elect, and there's a president elect, I mean, it's alarming. If on the day of swearing in, the president is not available and is nowhere to be found.
If he's ill.
If he's not available, okay, he cannot be seen, he cannot be cited. Okay. He's no, on the day of swearing in, the constitution says the vice president will be sworn in as president.
Wow.
So now, if you have a devious, and I hope the drafters of the constitution are also taking note of this. If you have a devious and evil genius who comes in as vice presidential or vice president elect, and he gets to the parade ground or to the ceremony, and he sees he's waiting, everybody's waiting, where's president, where's president, where's president? President is nowhere to be found. He'll be sworn in. Now, assuming he now plans to hijack even governor, deputy governor. So you have these clear provisions of the constitution in relation to that. Now, but you could find a situation where somebody will say, no, this is very dangerous. If you have a devious or evil deputy elect, in terms of vice president or deputy governor, who can plot or plan to hijack the governor elect or the president elect and keep him away somewhere. And then the next thing is, you now hear that the man has been sworn, and then suddenly the president shows up, the president-elect shows up. What then happens?
So it will be too late. But wait, well, what about, does this then go beyond, because don't forget, in elections, where they always talk about, you know, it can't be complete, either your nomination or election, without a vice or a deputy, either for governor or president.
No, we're looking at...
This has gone beyond that.
Yes, election has ended. The day of swearing in, the
man now they should have followed up that principle.
Yes.
In this case.
Yes. So you have a situation where the man is there, he has presented himself to be sworn in, and usually it is the deputy that will first be sworn in before the president. Right? So everyone is waiting for president to show up. President is nowhere to be found.
Well, so one of the conditions. One of the conditions.
That then means that he becomes vice president and president?
He has to come in as president.
Just as you said, he's first of all supposed to be sworn in as vice president.
Yes.
And then president.
When you can't find the president, where is the president?
One of the conditions that was given by the House of Reps to the governor is that all actions taken by the 7th Assembly members should be declared null and void pending proper inauguration.
It's wrong. With due respect to the House of representative, it is not vested with the power to make such a declaration or give such directive to the governor. We must understand the clear wordings of the constitution in relation to legislative powers and functions. Section 4 is very clear, and that's the beauty. You are empowered to make laws for the good order and good government in relation to legislative matters that come within your legislative competence, as contained in the exclusive legislative list. So it's clear. The law recognizes the House of Assembly of the state as being vested with the instrument of office, legislative powers, to make laws for the good order and government of the state. So clear separation or distinction of functions. Now, if there's an irregularity, it is not for the House to give such directive, because they're not reporting to the House of Representatives. They have their own rules and procedure. There's a law creating, the same law that empowers the National Assembly is what empowers the House of Assembly of the state. So they're clear institutions. The only constitutionally recognized situation where they can step in is also defined. And that's why I said, if you look at Section 11, From 1 to about 5, it talks about when the National Assembly can come in. It says National Assembly and not House of Assembly, of not House of Representatives. This is very apt.
So
and
is this the
and
same?
If you look at 305, for instance, where the president declares state of emergency, where legislative function can no longer be carried out by the House of Assembly of the state, it means all legislative functions of the House of Assembly of the state will now be vested in the National Assembly and not House of Representatives.
Are these indices playing out? Is it comparable to the situation in Bauchi State?
I don't think so. You see, one has to also be very careful, because I know that Bauchi State issue is, I think, is sub judice is currently in court. So we have to be very careful.
But if you look at Section 11.4, the circumstances in that particular one, does this 5 explain it, where it says, for the purposes of subsection 4 of this section, the House of Assembly shall not be deemed to be unable to perform its functions so long as the House of Assembly can hold a meeting and transact business.
Exactly what I said. I mean, it's very clear.
I mean, the quorum is formed.
Exactly. But so it's clear.
The intervention of the House of Representatives, as you know, we all know, came because this majority went to complain that they haven't been recognized. You know, so what's playing in my head, you know, now is, so now there's a kind of tussle between quorum and majority. Mm-hmm. Would you see it that way?
Well, I wouldn't say quorum and majority. The fact is a quorum was formed.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
The presumption is that the quorum was formed based on majority on ground. Now, the number of legislators who stayed off or who were not there at the point of inauguration will eventually make themselves available to the speaker. They have to be sworn in. And once they come in and they now form a majority, the legislative business of the House could be part of, and one is not going to tell them what to do. Yeah. They know what to do.
But having looked at this too, those who may be watching will think, okay, this, if I want to do something and if majority don't like it, this is what I can do. This is not what the drafters intended.
No, certainly not. And that's why I say, see, we must be very careful the way we do things in this country. The law is very clear. The law is not an orphan. Has clear provisions in terms of what to do. If you now decide to hijack the process, the courts are also there to beat you back online. No, you can't do so. Get back online. This is what you expected to do. That's why the courts are there, so that you do not give room to anarchy.
So
you don't bring about
these other members who have not been sworn in.
Yes.
Now, assuming they say, well, we presented ourselves, but they didn't swear us in, will they have a case?
Yes. Are you aware, for instance, the fact that they have not been sworn in means they're not yet members of the Edo
Senate? Can they go to court? In what grounds can
they go to
court?
Yes, no, they can go to court to simply say that the reason, give reasons why they are challenging this issue. But the fact is, have you made yourself available now to be sworn in?
So in the interest of justice, and perhaps for the good people of Edo State, should the governor reorder a proclamation?
For me, you can't have double proclamation. He's done one already. And you cannot tinker, neither will you alter the legislative book in terms of proceeding, because it has gone into the book.
Okay. So in fact, what the National Assembly or House of Reps should be doing is these areas where there are some sort of ambiguity that they raised in terms of the timing of the issuance of the proclamation, what the procedure has to be, if they want to make it clearer, as we did with the doctrine of necessity, they can amend the laws.
No. It's not, again, it's not for the House of Representatives.
The Constitution. The
Constitution is very clear. What is expected to be done? Mm-hmm. Question is, has it been done? The only grounds is that you have a group of persons who are saying, oh, we're not aware, we're not informed. Now, you remember what I said. Mm. If you have a criminally minded vice who decides to hijack the presence of the president-elect, he'll be sworn in. And then he would then, so to avoid all of that, so you sit back and you simply say, no, This particular provision can be abused. Somebody can take advantage of this. So what do we do to safeguard this? So you amend the constitution as you forge ahead.
And this is not taught in law school anyway.
No.
This is different. All right. Well, thank you for coming on this. This is Orisi Quaker, the Senior Advocate of Nigeria. Well, that's it this morning. Well, we'll be back in a moment. Stay with us.